10 and 50% of the medicine sold in developing countries could be, in fact, fake. In 2010, the counterfeit medicine industry is worth $75 billion.
They have no knowledge of pharmaceuticals. They're just trying to put something together that looks like the original product. Well, it's obviously quite shocking that people can make products in a backyard facility that could kill people.
I think that these are people who are basically looking to make money. To some of these people, medicine is just a commodity.
It's undoubtedly a disease of greed, because the motivation behind it is profit, and there is no concern for the harm that it causes.
You know, it's a clever industry. You know, there's a lot of money there. And so I think, you know, as much as we do in terms of trying to identify, you know, trying to kind of discriminate, you know, look at the discrimination between this hologram and this, the fake hologram and the true hologram, I think the counterfeiters will almost always be a step ahead of us.
You can find any medicine, any drug, which is having the margin, they are making fake medicines for their profit. If there is a profit, they will make it.
The Burmese border town of Tachilek, infamous as a haven of opium production and smuggling since the 1920s, is at the center of the Golden Triangle. Peddlers at the border market sell a dizzying array of fake products from China. Watches, alcohol, handbags, shoes, and a potentially lethal product, counterfeit medicine. Unsuspecting tourists pick up cheap goods, unaware of any danger posed by consuming shoddy imitations of medicines that can be deadly.
Where's that from? This morning. Yeah, where's this from?
This is.
Yeah.
Okay, CLS, this one too, this one, okay, $500, okay?
Yeah, where you get?
This here.
Yeah.
Viagra.
Where come from?
Strongman.
Where come from?
USA, no.
No.
There's estimates out there that I've read from authorities that say that even in the West, in developed countries, that 1% of the medicines there is potentially counterfeit. Of course, that goes higher in the developing countries, as I said, up to 50% or some estimates of the amount of fake medicines in the developing world.
Sukhumvit Road, the tourist center of Bangkok, boasts a dense layout of markets openly selling anything and everything, including counterfeit medicines, with no attempts to conceal or hide illicit products. Many products contain up to 5 times the recommended amount of active ingredients, a potentially lethal cocktail.
This one is 800 milligrams per pill. 800 milligrams of the active ingredient.
This blatant, in-your-face business is only possible through protection by the local mafia.
I saw first fake medicine in 1982. At that time, there were some generic people, those who were making generic medicines and their product was not in demand in the market and they are not getting very good profits. They started it by counterfeiting the big products available in the market of the big MNC companies. They started with that. And at that time, there were some products only, some, you can count it at that time.
Nowadays, we are facing a new trend of increased, antibiotics. Like general use antibiotics, amoxicillin, ampicillin, clarithromycin, these are take, the lead in terms of poor quality medicines in the region.
Counterfeit medicines commonly available in the market are antibiotics, painkillers, and yes, life-saving drugs.
La sophistication des contrefacteurs, en tout cas des criminels qui sont impliqués dans les trafics, est à la hauteur de la sophistication de leurs produits. Et on retrouve maintenant des contrefaçons de médicaments qui sont complètement à l'identique en termes d'identification de packaging. Donc on voit que les systèmes d'impression qui sont utilisés par les contrefacteurs sont excellents, voire parfois meilleurs que le produit d'origine, que la peinture utilisée, les couleurs sont absolument de très très bonne qualité et qu'il est parfois difficile de reconnaître le bon du mauvais sans avoir fait d'analyse chimique.
To distinguish between genuine and counterfeit medicines, analysts employ a number of technologies to determine authenticity. In Singapore, the Health Sciences Authority labs tested fake versions of Lipitor, a top-grossing cholesterol-lowering medication which flooded the global market in recent years.
A couple of days ago, an unknown sample of Lipitor was submitted to the laboratory. Today, we are going to run a series of tests on this unknown sample and then compare it to the authentic Lipitor that we have in the laboratory.
I'm looking at the packaging analysis of the samples. So on the left is the authentic sample and on the right is the unknown. I see differences in the printing quality between the two samples. The authentic sample is of a better printing quality than the unknown sample.
To the naked eye, counterfeit medicine can look identical to authentic medicine, so more sophisticated tests must sometimes be performed. One important test to determine the chemical composition and the active ingredient present in the pills is Raman spectroscopy. This method analyzes the different components of the unknown sample and compares them to the active ingredient in the authentic sample of the drug.
When the unknown sample is compared to the authentic sample, we can see that the chemical profile looks different. The active ingredient is detected in the authentic sample, but is not detected in the unknown sample.
We found that based on counterfeit standards, this is actually a very poor counterfeit sample. The sample, the unknown sample, compared to the authentic, is very, very different. And the worst thing is that when we checked for the quantitation by our pharmaceutical lab, when they quantitate the amount of active pharmaceutical ingredient in it, it was found to have none. That means there was no active ingredient that was present in the unknown sample of Lipitor that was submitted to us.
In developing countries, such as in the Mekong region of Southeast Asia, the threat comes from unlicensed retail outlets in remote areas, especially along international borders. Many of these mom and pop stores sell everyday household items alongside medicines, usually without a license.
They certainly know that the product is coming from outside the normal distribution channels. Normally when they order from the pharmaceutical company, it's delivered by the pharmaceutical company's distributor. But these counterfeit products are delivered by people on motorbikes, obviously outside the normal distribution channels, so that they know that they're either getting grey market or counterfeit stuff. I think there are some cases where they think they're selling grey market, but it's actually counterfeit. They think it's just maybe intended for another market, and they're getting it cheaper because they're avoiding taxes. But I think that there's definitely some cases where they're aware that they're selling counterfeit and go ahead and sell it.
Imported and locally produced medicines circulate through hundreds of wholesale outlets, eventually making their way to pharmacies and health facilities in the remote areas of the countryside. A vast majority of drugs for the private sector first come through the Olympic market, and the Cambodian Ministry of Health closely monitors the flow of these products from importation to retail distribution.
ទីមួយអំពីប្រព័ន្ធចែកចាយឱសថមានន័យថាបើសិនជាប្រព័័ន្ធចែកចាយឱសថនឹងថាមេកានីសដែលចែកចាយឱសថនឹងត្រឹមត្រូវមានការទទួលខុសត្រូវ
nó dương ai cắt mình thôi bán nếu ao cắt đấy phải chịu bỏ đất chụp bật ra rồi còn tua bán là sập lại lại tp vị thiên cá tam lâu chấm bám vị thiên cá tam lâu chấm bám mới miền đây tha ở nhà thôi con sập khả bị ba thì khả ba rồi xuống đôi chia lại nghe trong lần sập nữa miền ao cắt miền là tập hiệp cột quấn miền chụp bài cột quấn đừng cho tới tam đán trong miền đất cái này để luộc nam ở chấm bám thì bấy cá bánh hạt thông mới tiết cứ chầm luôn cả lấy lụa thân làm ở chỗ bạc nó xong thì cảm thấy chuyện ấy vì hạt đâu chiên nâu ra xa chầm luôn nó hạ bạc hay là ở chỗ bạc chiên mà còn cả lấy mình bên chỉ rừng khoa mà đà thế vì thế việc tiêm tia nơi mà chiêu bài cả nó vọt chỗ bạc thì cả hai nhà nó thông thì vì việc tiêm tia nó cả nhà đồ lực nó bỏ lại professional nè vì chỉ viện nó thông ไอ้ ที่ 3 ທໍາມະພອດຄືການອົບຮົມປະຊາບໍລັດສໍາຄັນນະຄືການອົບຮົມປະຊາບໍລັດນັ້ນຊ່ວງການເຈົ້າຖືວິທີການຈະຫມួយອັດບານດີຕຶກຸມວິທີການຈັ່ງ 3 ນັ້ນຊະບັບການອະນຸວັດຊະບັບດັກໂຕທີ 2 ຄືວັດທະທໍການປະກັນຍົກອິດຍາບອດຂອງໂປຣເຟສຊັນນອລນະທີ 3 ຄືຊັນຕະຂອງອະຍາທໍສະມານກິດໃຫ້ນັ້ນ ที่ 4 การตัวข้อตรัสระบบโปรเฟสชันนอลระบบเนี่ยวิธีจีบแบบต่างอ๋อโดยที่ฟาร์มาซีนั่งฟาร์มาซียังเถิดแต่มีเนี่ยลุ่นนั่งเถิดมีแต่การตัวข้อตรัสที่เป็นเสียสดการ์ไรให้นั่นลุ่นสดยังเถิดแต่มีมาเนี่ยสิกาเถิดอัดบัตรกัดนั่งขลุ่นท้ามุกระบอระบอเยอะเหมือนมันมุกระบอเดินจะที่หาท่ารกลุยรกกะขาดจำนั่งได้ขาดที่มุกระบอได้ยังรวมจำนายจะมวยนั่งกาปัดดอลสกปรกเพียบจุนไปที่บัวรอด นี่ไอ้เจี๊ยสุดเจี๊ยยูแมนไรเจี๊ยสุดระบบอาเจี๊ยชนสุดระบบเนี่ยจะงื้อสุดระบบเจี๊ยบรอดสุดระบบมนุษย์วิปดามเจนพิการกรุบกาปดอลเซวาสกับเพียบปดอลอสุดประกอบด้วยคุณอภิบบอสุดขมิ้นคุณอภิบก้มเลยยิ่งอัมพีเรื่องสุดมนุษย์ย้ำซัวเกได้บรรทายขวานทายย้ำซัวนั่งเป็ดเกย้ำไม่ตายเมื่อไงขายย้ำซัวเกย์จังบรรทายโดยเจี๊ย ยังดังทามาเตะเกตุเตอร์ไหมจะพูดยังด้วยจิตตกจัดเลยกลายหลุดน้ำดังได้ดังทำคลายคลายดังไม่พอยังด้วยทายยังมันสกอตน้ำหมอยังก่อนดาเคเปิดกระทาเลยยังตัดเต็งน้ำตัดสายจะไอ้น้ำตัดสายมั้ยยังจะตัดเล็บตามบนเปิดเกอไอ้มาเตยยังเติมซ้อมเก็บซ้อมเอาไว้เตยยังเลือดตามแค่ใหญ่ตายยังตอมอันเต็งปากน้ำนั่งไงตายเพื่อฉันมาเต็งจากหลายก่อนนี่ไง
Drug-resistant strains of malaria were first identified along the Thai-Cambodian border. Of major international concern is the threat of the spread of these strains to areas with high rates of malaria, such as the African continent, which would have devastating consequences. Researchers have linked the contribution of poor quality medicines to the development of drug-resistant strains of malaria. In areas with limited financial and human resources, it is difficult to monitor and regulate the cross-border flows of people and commodities. Fake and poor quality medicines infiltrate the border markets, especially in areas with weak regulation and a lack of public awareness about the dangers of these types of products.
On peut considérer, si vous voulez, que sur les 750 000 personnes qui décèdent chaque année, hein, selon les sources officielles du paludisme, il y a environ 150 à 200 000 morts qui pourraient être évitées si les antipaludiques en circulation contenaient le principe actif par an. Oui.
Clearly, this is a reasonable number, I mean, given the scope of the problem, but I would add that it might even be an underestimate for the following reason. You have situations where there's treatment failure as a result of taking medicines that purport to be medicines, but they are not. And as a result, patients succumb to the disease. I wonder how many of these situations are being included in the calculation of the fatality.
Mesot is a town nestled on the Moy River of the western Thailand border with Burma, home to thousands of migrant workers who cross into Thailand seeking stable employment and essential medical services. In the informal street markets, a colorful array of dubious medicines from Burma is widely available. These unregistered medicines and herbal products from across the river provide migrant workers with familiar remedies against many diseases, including malaria, one of the major concerns among this population. Organizations such as the Shoklo Malaria Research Unit provide much-needed outreach and healthcare to vulnerable people on both sides of the river. A recent case of a malaria patient who had taken fake artesanate to treat his illness inside Burma was reported by the clinic. Thinking he was being cured, the patient had unwittingly consumed an ineffective medication with tragic consequences.
Of course, it was dramatic because the patient died. We managed to get hold of the tablets of artesanate that he had used and analyzed it, and it was totally counterfeit. There was nothing in it. And to trace back the shop in the village where he had bought this tablets, and there was an interesting reaction from the village community, and the village head called for a meeting and explained to the people that it was dangerous to buy drugs in like this, and they collect all the medicine they could find in the village and burnt everything.
I find it unbelievable that people do that, you know, so it's kind of to manufacture a drug that they know can potentially kill someone because someone takes it in the belief. Someone with malaria will take it in the belief that's going to cure them. They might have come, you know, they might have traveled for a day to get to somewhere where they can get a drug, they buy the drug, they think it's going to cure them, they go back home. They don't have time to kind of go back again and get a good quality drug.
The initial data that we collected suggested that it was widely spread over the whole of mainland Southeast Asia, from western Burma through to southern Vietnam and to southern China. Over especially poor communities that had no other access to antimalarials. So in 2005, with very little happening to try to stop this problem, we collaborated with WHO, with Interpol, and with a range of forensic laboratories to try and obtain evidence as to where these may have been coming from. We had our suspicions, but we had no firm evidence. So by doing that, we looked at the type of chalk in the tablets. I assumed before that chalk was chalk, but no, there are many different types of chalk. And the chalk that was found was a type that is only mined on a large scale in southern China. And we also looked for traces of plant material, of pollen within the tablets. And that again suggested that the tablets had an origin either of the raw material or were being manufactured in southern China or in an area near there. Obviously, with wind blowing pollen, it's not a very accurate tool, but it suggested that it was from that general region.
The traditional path of spread of drug resistance in the past to chloroquine and to sulfadoxine pyrimethamine in Plasmodium falciparum was to move westward, to cross over Thailand, through Myanmar into India, and then into the African continent. And so the nightmare scenario of a global pandemic of artemisinin resistance with accompanying increase in morbidity and mortality is obviously what we must stop at all costs.
If you have a substandard drug, so an artesanate, and it's in a low dose and not in the full dose, then from the resistance point of view, that's fantastic for the parasite. Whereas a good quality, you know, genuine product, hopefully it should knock out the parasite.
để ai chia ba bàn ở mà thằng malaria chuyện người quân chẳng chia ba ở tại buôn đọc đô la thế chi chẳng chờn hết ấy không đại quạt slap bàn dương miên thứ năm availability of drug anti malaria drug hết ấy còn mình access tới đó bây giờ bọn bạn hết ấy còn bây giờ bọn access tới những fake drug tới những số này lại những số sinh nhà này ta ca slap bọc bị chưa vừa rót ở rồi rồi nè ní via chia pop hiện sầm nắng bọc này rồi có chia cầm hốc chia mistake chia cầm hốc là bỏ ở đây system dương chứng bệnh cha này nè.
It was in this hall here where our collaboration between WHO and Interpol started. In 2005, the WHO Regional Office for the Western Pacific, jointly with the Southeast Asian Regional Office, organized in here a meeting on counterfeit medicines. We had in our hands samples of these fake artesunate. And through this collaboration, a very sophisticated forensic investigation was launched with the aim to find the production site as well as distribution rings and of course with the aim to disrupt both production and distribution.
Alors, au cours des enquêtes que nous avons pu coordonner avec Interpol dans la lutte contre cette contrefaçon, l'un des défis auxquels nous sommes confrontés, c'est de retracer l'origine des produits contrefaits. Et en Asie du Sud-Est, nous avons vu des contrefaçons de médicaments qui étaient extrêmement bien faites, donc avec un packaging complètement sophistiqué, qui était même très difficile à détecter pour les détenteurs de droits, mais qui également venaient de plusieurs sources différentes. Sur l'enquête que nous avions faite en 2005, un des sites de production était situé en Chine. Donc lorsque nous avions commencé à travailler avec les services de police chinois, ils avaient réussi à pouvoir déterminer l'endroit et les zones géographiques où étaient situées ces productions d'antimalaria contrefaits. Par la suite, nous avons constaté que la Chine n'était pas le seul endroit où ces antimalarias pouvaient être faits, produits et également distribués dans les pays. Donc nous essayons vraiment de travailler main dans la main avec chacun des pays en Asie du Sud-Est et en Asie en général, comprendre leurs spécificités, comprendre leurs défis de façon à pouvoir nous assister les pays qui ont besoin de savoir d'où viennent les produits.
The lifeblood of Southeast Asia, the Mekong River traverses and connects six countries, acting as a highway for the transit of products and people throughout the region. Despite efforts to police and control them, the borders along the river are difficult to monitor. Cross-border trafficking in black market products such as illicit drugs, jade, amphetamines, and fake medicines is facilitated by the porous nature of these borders. Counterfeit medicines smuggled from China, India, and Pakistan are repackaged in transit countries destined for both local and third country markets. Once the fake product leaves the point of manufacture, it can be repackaged multiple times for multiple local markets around the world, including internet distribution. Botan is a notorious transit point for illicit products crossing from China into Laos and on into the southern Mekong countries. Caravans of 18-wheelers carry tons of products through the border and customs checkpoints every day. Massive quantities of goods transiting this border point are nearly impossible to monitor, and only a fragment of bulk shipments are thoroughly checked by customs and border police. Customs agents use a single large-scale X-ray machine to examine the shipment containers in an attempt to identify inconsistencies in the contents. However, the sheer volume and number of trucks poses an enormous challenge to local officials.
ยาปลอมก็คือยาอันบ่ได้มาตรฐานภายหลังที่ว่าเฮาพบเห็นแล้วเฮาก็ได้ยึดเนาะโดยสมทบภาคส่วนที่เกี่ยวข้องไปต้นแม่นอาหารและยาเนาะและก็ตำรวจหรือว่าการค้าเนาะอันนี้ก็เช่นเดียวกันเนาะที่ว่าผู้เฮากวดกาผู้เห็นและก็บ่มีอนุญาตก็บ่ฮู้ว่ายาชนิดใดสิเอานําสิเอาไปนําใส่แบบใดเฮาก็ยังบ่ฮู้
ทรัพยากรบ่เพียงพอทรัพยากรนี่หมายถึงพนักงานหมายถึงว่าพาหนะอุปกรณ์ในงบประมาณในการกวดกามีจำกัดเนาะมีจำกัดแต่ว่าทรัพยากรในเฮาบ่สามารถเฮี้ยนห้องโดยเฮาเองได้แม่นเฮาต้องได้ใช้สิ่งที่เฮามีแล้วอย่างมีประสิทธิผล
แต่ฮู้แล้วว่าผู้ใดเป็นผู้เฮ็ดแม่นคนเฮ็ดเพื่อหาผลกําไรหาผลประโยชน์และคนประเภทนี้ผลิตยาปลอมและยาตกมาตรฐานนี่แม่นคนที่บ่มีจรรยาบรรณวิชาชีพจรรยาธรรมการแพทย์
Alors il est vrai que la plus belle invention, je dirais, du XXe siècle, c'est la conteneurisation, l'utilisation du conteneur. Actuellement, envoyer de la marchandise de Chine en France, c'est quasiment moins cher que faire un Paris-Bordeaux. Ça paraît incroyable, mais c'est comme ça. Les bateaux contiennent de 11 000 à 12 000 conteneurs. Un conteneur, ça fait 20 pieds, c'est à peu près 33 mètres cubes. C'est énorme au niveau de la marchandise, et donc c'est une grosse facilité. Grosse facilité d'utiliser les transports, pourquoi ? Anonymisation des transports. Vous pouvez envoyer des choses et vous n'apparaissez pas forcément. Grosse difficulté de contrôle par les douanes. Par ailleurs, les douanes vont contrôler à l'import que entre 2 à 5% des marchandises physiques à l'importation. Donc tout le reste, ça se fait par des contrôles documentaires, des contrôles différents, mais pas physiques. On ne peut pas arrêter un conteneur. Il faudrait 1 million de douaniers pour contrôler tous les conteneurs qui vont circuler simplement dans un pays. Ce n'est pas possible.
Many counterfeit medicines and other illegal products are often shipped via the regular postal service. They are sent from the point of manufacture through repackaging sites and then on to retail markets at final destinations around the world. Everything from lifestyle drugs to dietary supplements and steroids are distributed globally and are likely ordered through online internet retailers. Counterfeiters create fake packaging with fake labels, trying to deceive customs agents regarding the true source of the product.
Ça aussi, donc là, ce sera pas écrit dessus en thaïlandais, parce que ça veut faire croire que c'est du vrai, qui n'est pas fabriqué là-bas.
C'est pareil, c'est un médicament. Voilà. C'est pas de la contrefaçon, c'est un médicament qui n'a pas le droit d'être vendu en France en banque libre.
De façon très massive d'Asie, voilà. Ça, il n'y a pas de problème. Et comme je vous disais, le textile, ce serait plutôt le Vietnam, la Thaïlande, le Cambodge. Tout ce qui est électronique, ce serait plutôt la Chine, Hong Kong et Singapour, qui n'est qu'un centre de transport, enfin de regroupage, de regroupement.
It involves transnational criminal organization, basically, because when it comes, it cross transnational boundaries. Almost at the same time. We used to receive report medicine that are counterfeited in country in North Asia. Immediately after that, we received the same reports from Southeast Asian countries, such within less than 10 days. Meaning that they are widely distributed, rapidly distributed across national boundaries.
We have found horrific ingredients in some counterfeit medicines that we found. We found rat droppings, we found dirt, we found lead paint, we found methamphetamines, all used as ingredients in counterfeit medicines. So you have the innocent patient and their doctor prescribing and consuming medicines, and if they're not getting it from a trusted source, you don't know what you're going to get.
I found a lot of people, those who are mafias, previously selling heroin, smack, some narcotics, they came into the field saying that in the narcotics field, there is high risk, lesser money than the counterfeit drugs.
I think that these are people who are basically looking to make money. I believe that these also are people that might trade between medicines to drugs, illegal drugs, money laundering, to sales of arms. I mean, to some of these people, a medicine is just a commodity.
On dit un chiffre, alors c'est des chiffres, faut faire toujours très attention, hein. Mais les chiffres actuellement, c'est quoi? On dit que pour 1000 dollars, si vous faites du faux médicament, votre retour sur investissement peut être entre 200 000 à 450 000 dollars. Enfin, je veux dire, quand vous voyez ce genre de chiffres, c'est clair qu'il y a un attrait pour n'importe qui, et en particulier pour les organisations criminelles. Au niveau des chiffres, en revanche, plus il y a de saisies qui sont faites, plus on trouve de la contrefaçon de médicaments. En Europe, par exemple, en 2009, une opération est faite par les douanes européennes. Pendant 2 mois, 34 millions de comprimés ont été saisis.
Moi, ยังน้อยไปแต่ถ้าโทษมันนี่ยังไม่สูงพอผมว่านี่เป็นเรื่องอันตรายเพราะว่าเป็นสิ่งที่เกี่ยวข้องกับชีวิตเราเรารับประทานยาเข้าไปเนี่ยเราไม่รู้ว่าเราต้องไปเสี่ยงอะไรกับยาปลอมหรือไม่ร่างกายเราจะเป็นยังไงถึงแม้อาจจะมีการหายเบื้องต้นแล้วยาอาจจะสะสมในร่างกายสรุปแล้วการที่เราบริโภคยาเข้าไปเพื่อรักษาตัวเองเนี่ย ถ้าเป็นยาปลอมมันอันตรายชีวิตเพราะฉะนั้นโทษคนที่ผลิตหรือคนที่ทำยาปลอมเนี่ยน่าจะโทษถึงชีวิตเหมือนกันเราต้องปรับโทษให้มันสูงขึ้นกว่านี้เพราะว่าจะได้เป็นการป้องปรามหรือไม่ให้ผู้รับผิดเนี่ยอยากกระทำเพราะฉะนั้นยาปลอมก็น่าจะมีโทษใกล้เคียงกับยาเสพติด
Cartels and the drug organized crime groups would often break up their criminal organizations into various cells. So if law enforcement would raid one part of their cell, it wouldn't affect the others, so that they would have the manufacturing in one, the distribution in another, the packaging in another. Now we're seeing, because of the organized crime groups becoming involved in that, they're replicating that business model. And so when we've been working with local law enforcement, where they've conducted these raids of these manufacturing and distribution organizations, oftentimes we're only finding one cell or one part of that. So it's becoming more and more difficult, and the criminals are becoming more and more sophisticated.
เมื่อวันที่8มกราคม255ปีนี้นะครับเวลาช่วงบ่ายเนี่ยได้รับแจ้งจากศูนย์วิทยุเนี่ยขณะที่ผมเข้าเวรเนี่ยว่ามีคนพบศพในมีคนตายอยู่ในโรงแรมธีรดาการ์เด้นจึงได้รุดไปตรวจสอบนะครับเมื่อไปถึงเนี่ยก็ได้เข้าไปแต่ตรวจสอบในห้องก็พบว่ามีผู้ตายทราบชื่อภายหลังคือนายพันศักดิ์จันทร์ประเสริฐเนี่ยนอนสภาพเนี่ยก็คือนอนอยู่ข้างเตียงในสภาพที่ว่าคว่ำหน้าโดยขณะนั้นเนี่ยก็นุ่งผ้าเช็ดตัวแค่ผืนเดียวหลังจากนั้นเนี่ยจึงได้ไปตรวจค้นภายในห้องเนี่ยก็ได้พบถุงยาก็เห็นว่ามียาไวอาก้าอยู่นะครับแพทย์ก็บอกว่าน่าจะเป็นของประเทศจีนนะฮะที่ทำปลอมขึ้นมา
Aujourd'hui le faux médicament est considéré comme un délit et ce n'est pas un délit.C'est un crime. Vous savez, parmi les slogans que nous avions participé à créer avec d'autres, et d'autres organisations, nous n'en sommes pas d'ailleurs les détenteurs, hein, mais il y avait ce fameux slogan « le médicament de la rue, ça tue », eh bien, oui, c'est vrai, ça peut tuer. Hein. Et donc, pour moi, ça n'est plus un délit, mais c'est un crime.
Countries around the world and their public side have to take this as the crime that it is. Oftentimes, many countries and their governments think that this is an intellectual property issue. This is beyond an intellectual property issue. People can die from this.
A handful of organizations are working to combat the proliferation of counterfeit medicines in Southeast Asia.Among them is the Promoting the Quality of Medicines program, implemented by the non-profit organization United States Pharmacopeia. This global program is funded by USAID to help strengthen pharmaceutical quality assurance systems in the developing world. The PQM program supports many activities to ensure that good quality essential medicines are available in the public and private sectors, and is active in Thailand, Vietnam, Lao PDR, Cambodia, and Myanmar. Routine surveillance of poor quality medicines has generated encouraging results, as early detection of fakes is crucial to protect the public's health. Great progress has been made in Cambodia through active closure of illegal outlets and increased surveillance of retail pharmacies. Based on established protocols and timelines, project teams from the Mekong countries routinely go into the field and collect medicine samples from over 50 sites in Southeast Asia, recording data about sample type and location. Teams collect medicines from private retail pharmacies, hospitals, clinics, and public health facilities targeting infectious disease medicines. The teams are not only looking for counterfeits, but are also looking for legitimate products which may have unintended quality defects.
การเก็บตัวอย่างยาหันแม่นเป้าหมายก็แน่ใส่ติดตามคุณภาพยาอยู่ตามท้องตลาดหรือว่าการสกัดกันยาปลอมเนาะหรือว่าหลังจากเก็บได้แล้วพวกเขาก็จะมีไปเข้าแบบฟอร์มว่าสรุปสั่งรวมว่ายาเก็บมาแต่ใส่เข้ารหัสหลังจากนั้นก็จะส่งเข้าห้องแลบเพื่อวิจัยคุณภาพหลังจากวิจัยเราก็จะเอา 10% ของยาจำนวนหนึ่งส่งให้กรมอาหารและยาเพื่อวิจัยขึ้นอีกครั้งหนึ่ง
Team members undergo extensive specialized training on how to sample medicines and conduct field screening tests, including data management and reporting. Antimalarials and other anti-infective medicines are collected for later testing back at the lab. Many counterfeits cannot be identified by simple visual inspection, and thus need to be chemically tested to determine the quality of the product. Medicines collected in the field are screened using portable mini-labs. Mini-labs are small, self-contained chemical testing units used in identifying medicines and detecting counterfeits. After the analysts perform the tests, the data is accurately recorded on the sample forms. Results are quickly communicated to the national regulatory authorities, who can then take action. The Medicine Quality Assurance System fosters good cooperation and partnerships between health programs, customs, and police, as well as between the public and private sectors.
We're in a time of limited resources around the world. Governments around the world are cutting back budgets, and even more so in developing countries. We know that, and so what has to happen is we have to look to build partnerships. One of the best ways to build a partnership is a public-private partnership. That's what we try to do. We recognize we have an obligation to protect our patients. So we want to help law enforcement. We recognize that there are limitations to what they can do. So that's where we step in. Where can we help? We do that in a lot of ways. One, we try to develop intelligence on criminal organizations that are involved in this trafficking.
That we're hired by the private companies. Often it's a product that they're concerned about, that they might have had some complaints about, or their sales teams might have come across counterfeit in the market. So then they will select those products and come and ask us to do to survey for those specific products. Our investigators will go out into the market and buy from normal shops. They'll just walk into the pharmacy as if they're a normal customer and buy one or two items in that shop. And then they'll maybe cover 20, 25 shops in a day and bring the samples back to the office where we photograph them and then send them off to the clients to be analyzed.
ก็คือเดี๋ยววันนี้เราจะแบ่งเป็น2ทีมนะครับ ็ทีมแรกจะอยู่กับผมทีมที่2ก็อยู่กับผู้กองทีมดีนะครับ
We're going to go to a location and we're going to give you money.
Yeah.
You're going to go in and purchase Viagra.
Okay.
And you're going to come back to the van, blue van, you'll see parked nearby.
Okay.
You'll come inside. There'll be myself and a couple of policemen in there. You'll give me the pills. We'll test it right on the spot to see if it's real or fake.
Yeah, okay.
The Viagra is counterfeit. It's quite easy to tell for a lot of reasons. One, this stripe is normally a light blue color. Viagra should be written in a light blue color. In Thailand, this symbol does not appear on the box. The Viagra tablet purchased in a TrueScan machine, which provides an almost instant analysis through doing a laser read of the contents of the tablets, and it gives an almost instant analysis as to whether or not the tablet is authentic or counterfeit.
Fam, it's counterfeit.
แต่ถ้าไม่ให้ความร่วมมือพี่เอาหมดเลยนะความผิดน่ะ
ไม่เป็นไรไม่เป็นไร
เรื่องอยู่ตรงไหน
ขอบัตรด้วยครับพี่หยิบจากไหน
ก็มีกล่องเดียวค่ะ
หยิบจากไหนกล่องยาหยิบจาก
ไหนก็มีกล่องเดียว
ตะกี้น้องวางไว้ไหนยาที่ยาวางไว้ไหน
ไม่ต้องคุยกันแล้วไม่ต้องคุยกันแล้วเดี๋ยวจะเดี๋ยวถ้าตามไปตามไปที่โรงพักบางละมุงเลยนะคะ
เราก็ต้องมาตรวจนะ
เขาเป็นขอยอสองขยับขาไม่ได้หมดแล้วเนี่ย
เอาลงตรวจมา
เดี๋ยวหมดเหรอ
ไม่ใช่น้องตั้งเอาไปน้องตั้งเอาไปแล้วน้องก็
นี่เจ้าหน้าที่ตำรวจนะ
น้องอย่าขัดขืนนะ
มี
เพิ่มข้อหาหนึ่งนะ
ปล่อย
ตังเขาไม่เอาอยู่แล้ว
เขาไม่เอาตังอยู่แล้ว
มองหยุดหยุด
น้องก็มองดูนะไม่เป็นไรตังไม่ด้วยไปไม่มีปัญหาเอาหยิบตัง
นี่ไงเนี่ยไม่เอาหรอก
แล้วผมหยิบให้ทุกคนอย่ามือวุ่นดิ
เอ้ย
ตังเอาไป
ต้องถ่ายค่ะเพราะว่าอันนี้เจ้าหน้าที่ตำรวจอย่าขัดขืนค่ะ
ไม่ใช่
เขาเป็นใคร
ดาวเอาอะไรเนี่ยยาอยู่
ต้องมีหมายด้วยไม่ใช่หรือพี่ไม
่ We gave the undercover operative money. He went in. He made the purchases of the suspected counterfeit. Brought it out. And we were able to do testing in the field. We found that it was counterfeit. The police went in with the FDA here in Thailand and did the raids. We resulted in arrests of individuals that were selling counterfeit products out of these pharmacies. We were able to hit 5 pharmacies today that were selling counterfeit. And it wasn't just the Pfizer products that we found. We found that they were selling a wide variety of products that endanger consumers' health, such as weight loss medicines. We found out that like cardiovascular medicines, antibiotics, medicines related to pregnancy support. We even found in some were selling yaba, amphetamines, illegal amphetamines on the street.
ก็พยายามปรับฐานเนื่องจากเครื่องตรวจของกรมวิทยาศาสตร์การแพทย์ก็มีจำนวนจำกัดนะฮะก็มีผลในการที่ว่าคดีจะล่าช้านะครับแต่แนวนโยบายในการทำงานของผมที่ร่วมกับคณะกรรมการรัฐยาเนี่ยเน้นในเรื่องของยาปลอมเรื่องของผลิตภัณฑ์สุขภาพที่อันตรายต่างๆประชาชนผู้บริโภคเนี่ยทุกวันนี้มีความรู้น้อยผมใช้วิธีการโดยการจับแหล่งผลิตแหล่งนำเข้าต่างๆนะครับแล้วก็ใช้วิธีใช้สื่อในการประชาสัมพันธ์ว่าประกาศเลยว่าที่ดินแดงเนี่ยเราจับมาเนี่ยมีตัวยาอะไรบ้างที่เป็นยาปลอมให้ประชาชนเลิกบริโภคและขายยาที่มีอยู่ก็ต้องรีบเก็บห้ามขายไม่งั้นเราจะไปจับกลุ่มหรือผลิตภัณฑ์อาหารเสริมต่างๆเครื่องสำอางต่างๆที่อันตรายไม่ปลอดภัยในการใช้แล้วก็จับแล้วแถลงข่าวให้สื่อมวลชนช่วยเป็นสื่อในการที่ให้ผู้บริโภคเนี่ยได้รู้และเข้าใจว่าผลิตภัณฑ์ต่างๆที่เราใช้อยู่ทุกวันนี้มีความปลอดภัยยังไงหรือไม่ถ้าผู้บริโภคมีความรู้มากๆเรื่อยๆผลิตภัณฑ์ที่ผิดกฎหมายก็จะหมดไปนะครับ
เปียปอนหนึ่งการเงินการบากเบียบดอกดานี่คือเชียร์บงยิ่งส่งไปเจ้าท่าក្រោយពីមានកិច្ចព្រមព្រៀងសហប្រតិបត្តិការរវាងសាធារណរដ្ឋបារាំងនិងប្រជាជនកម្ពុជាដែលចុះហត្ថលេខានៅខែមិថុនាឆ្នាំ2010ដែលយើងទទួលនៅមូលនិធិនេះឡើងដើម្បីរួមគ្នាទប់ស្កាត់ផលិតផលខ្លាំងៗដែលមានហានិភ័យខ្ពស់ដល់សុខភាពនិងសុវត្ថិភាពសាធារណៈ នៅប្រទេសកម្ពុជាជាពិសេសគឺស្គាល់ធ្ងន់ទៅលើអនុមន្ទិលីមេគង្គដែលមានបីប្រទេសប៉ុន្តែប្រទេសកម្ពុជាយើងទទួលបានមុនគេនៅមូលនិធិនេះបាទហើយក្នុងគោលដៅមូលនិធិនេះគឺថាចូលរួមទាំងអស់គ្នាក្នុងការទប់ស្កាត់និងបង្ក្រាបផលិតផលខ្លាញ់ខ្លាយបាទហើយក្រោយពីនឹងមកដំបីឲ្យមន្ត្រីដែលអនុវត្តច្បាប់ពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងការបង្ក្រាបបទផលិតផលខ្លាញ់ខ្លាយនេះទៀមទីឲ្យមន្ត្រីនឹងគឺថាគាត់ត្រូវតែយល់ដ ตีปีนึกถ้าคือจ้องเอาเมียนกาสักการ์คนนี้หาได้บานเมียนแบบประดบดานกันแล้วมา
Is against hypertensive. Oui, tout est fabriqué en Chine, mais sans aucune molécule active à l'intérieur. C'est vraiment de la contrefaçon pure.
Chia bát thắm khiom bát, som nai mang luôn. Là khiom bát say tơ sun ra, ni ca lấy ca pi lấy bát man luôn. Phía bên này dục than có bao sản lượng sẽ cách. Hỏi có chia nẹt sầm lo sầm ruột cùng luôn. AMF ấm, đài.ตุกสกัดนั่งประชังกาเกิดพอสับไหลคล้ายนั่งสับกลุ่นใจได้ซ้อมนั่งจุ่มเงือกกลุ่นใจได้กลอมเมาส์มีการตัดตาบอลพรมแดนกัมจีไทยบ่าให้ปลิกโดยอหลุดดังหายท่าปลิเซติกคือเมียนตูนตีบ่าตูนตีบอกล้วนตามประกาศได้มาเพย์ใบจัดใบบอกไอ้ตอมบุปผาอยู่รอนใจซอกเฮงได้เอาปลิเซติกเมียนตูนตีนำใบอันดับบอดสาวชื่อตุบสกัดนั่งกราบบอดละมือจิตฉลาดจีบิเซ่คือบอดละมือออสซัดคล้ายๆนั่งออสซัดกลุ่นใจห้ามขอนี่บ่าหาโดยชนะให้บ้านจียืงมีนสกรรมแบบเพียบฉลาดจีบตอบตอบได้กระลองม้อยบ่าโลกบ้านเคยให้กระทาสมัติพอลบอลอยู่ทางกับบ้านทางโซเซกิกบ้านบังกราบออสซัดคล้ายๆในกรงผมปิ้งบ่าจีบตอบตอบได้เกิดดอลปีนี้กระทาสรบม้าบ่าให้จีจิตสายสตอน
More than half of medicines purchased through the internet are fake, according to the World Health Organization. The internet is used by traffickers to move products not only through bulk wholesaling, but through retail sales to individuals around the world. Patients are duped by flashy websites offering up drugs without prescriptions, from lifestyle to life-saving remedies. Unless a website is verified by a stringent regulatory authority, there is no guarantee of the safety or authenticity of the products being purchased.
We found a variety of different methods that they use. Sometimes it's just posted in through normal mail services or courier services. A lot of them are transported by couriers. They'll take a flight with a couple of suitcases full of medicines and that's probably the most common method that we've seen, is couriers coming in on flights.
Even in their smuggling across our borders, it used to be that they could be quite blatant with this because oftentimes customs or law enforcement officials didn't know what they were smuggling.
I think that probably they'll have some relationships with customs officers that they won't get searched and that they'll be let through.
In September 2012, a massive international operation coordinated by Interpol mobilized police, customs agents, regulatory authorities, and private sector companies from over 100 countries to crack down on the illegal sale of counterfeit medicines through the internet. The operation netted seizures worth $12 million, arrested 112 individuals, and shut down 18,000 illegal online pharmacy websites around the world.The tide of internet crime is rising, and the global distribution of counterfeit medicines through online sales is rising with it. As long as there is a market, the illicit and immoral industry of fake drugs will continue to be a profitable venture. Criminals will continue to manufacture dangerous products in uncontrolled and unregulated facilities such as this one. These are the conditions under which counterfeit medicines are produced: unsterile, unhygienic, and unregulated. In hidden and dank warehouses, black market pills are pressed for worldwide delivery. Are we willing to risk our health, our lives, and the lives of our family when seeking treatments from unknown sources? Are the efforts by authorities to curb the rising tide of internet distribution enough to ensure our safety? We as consumers and patients must be empowered through awareness and education to make informed choices. The problem is getting worse, yet we must continue to fight against the illicit trade in counterfeit medicines, to battle against those who leave a wake of despair in the shadow of their deceit.